We are now switching to the reflections. We will have two speakers. The first one will be Professor Ülle Madise. She's a professor of constitutional law and also an expert in constitutional law. She has been long serving currently as a Chancellor of Justice of Estonia, but also has held several very, very important positions. So we probably hear now more about lawmakers and scientists' communications. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Saarma. Dear Mr. President Soomere, distinguished guests, it's really a great honor to speak in front of such a high-level audience. And I really thank you for this opportunity. Unfortunately, I was yesterday out of the country, and so I couldn't follow the discussions of yesterday, but I'm sure that I can learn from what you did remember and write down. But following Professor Marju Lauristin, I also would like to share three personal stories, or experiences to be exact. Before assuming my current position, legal chancellor of Estonia, it's the head of a constitutional institution designed to protect overall constitutionality and to protect people's rights in Estonia. I used to work mainly as professor of constitutional law at the University of Tartu. And many years ago, Toomas Hendrik Ilves, the president of the Republic, then at that time, invited me to advise him in constitutional matters. Of course, I said yes. Soon after I started my work as legal advisor to the president, he decided to veto a law passed by the parliament. And President Ilves asked me to draft a letter to the parliament with the explanations of his decision, his motives and reasoning. Stuff as usual. Estonians here in this auditorium know that the presidential veto is serious stuff in our political system, used maybe once a year or even less. And so I took the task very seriously and professionally. Furthermore, it was an excellent example of legal and scientific writing, what I did. At least so I felt. I was really proud and satisfied with my work. President Ilves read it through, looked a bit confused and lost, and finally asked if I could write the same things in a clear, understandable, and much shorter way. Mr. Ilves, now a visiting scholar at Stanford, was completely right. If you want to have impact, to make a difference, you must maintain your ethics as scientist, be exact, use logic, remain independent, but you also have to be clear. It means others must understand you and your message. My colleagues, it's possible. And that's the reason why I changed the way the legal chancellor's office communicates with people. It was very difficult to make clear to lawyers that they have to write like human beings in a normal way. And that is also law. Clear message is inter alia a way to respect the dignity of others. I firmly believe in it. Of course, it's much more demanding to write clearly and briefly than simply to write. Why so? It's quite clear. Because if you want to write briefly and clear, you have to know what you write, and you should be ready to take responsibility. The Institute of Estonian Language runs clear message movement and annual clear message competition. For the last 3 years, I've been the patron of this movement. This year, one of the winners was a piece from our public radio, News of Science. News of Science. Every morning, exactly at 8:30, there is a piece about a new and most important scientific breakthrough or finding. It runs for 3 minutes. 3 minutes. And is really condensed but perfectly worded conclusion of some longer article from Nature, Science, etc. Mr. Britt Ennett, the author and editor of these pieces, can even describe the growing of grass in exciting terms. Why I'm telling it? Again, I believe in science we need to communicate the results of our research in a short, logical, and clear manner. And this doesn't affect our reputation as scientists. On the contrary, people have, and now I would like to use an expression in my first and favorite foreign language, in German language, people have Nase voll of experts because they feel themselves left out of the picture, not treated as equals and with dignity. Yes, we may expect and sometimes even demand blind trust in experts and science. But unfortunately, many don't share this kind of trust anymore. Furthermore, it has become popular to openly ignore science, facts, and truth. As my colleague, a legal scholar, Cass Robert Sunstein, currently professor at Harvard Law School, warned already 10 years ago, Internet has given rise to an era of enclaves and niches. It's recalled in recent MIT Technology Review. Quite interesting reading, I recommend. Francis Fukuyama argues in an essay published in Der Spiegel 10 days ago that the only way to save democracy and rule of law is to bring people back out of these niches and enclaves, to bring them back again. And I believe that we, scholars, have much to do in this respect. The third piece of my reflection comes in the form of personal history on binding research and decision making. And it is a little bit different. In the beginning of this millennium, I belonged to a team of lawyers and IT specialists who designed Estonian online voting system. As you know, Estonia is the only country in the world who allows online voting with binding results, remote online voting with binding results on countrywide elections. An innovation usually comes along when different disciplines and experiences meet for the first time. Believe me or not, but it took a whole day to understand each other's language. A whole day. We left Tallinn for 2 days, IT specialists and lawyers, all the heads of IT security of the banks, scientists from universities, lawyers. And I can say that it was really a time and money well spent. It came out that we all were self-conscious, what was not a surprise, of course, and we believed that we knew everything about the matter. We lawyers thought that we know everything about technology, and IT guys thought that they know everything about constitutionality. And for hours and hours, we didn't understand why there were communication gaps. To give you a simple example, I manifested clearly that the electronic ballot must remain anonymous as it does in paper envelopes. Not possible, came immediate answer from the tech guy. Soon it came out that lawyers and mathematicians perceive theory of certainty in a different way. And instead of conclusion, fourth story. It's about two monks. Two monks are standing on the road with a sign in their hands. Stop, contemplate, think about your life, turn around, otherwise you will be dead soon. A car rushes by without stopping. In less than a minute, a sound of a terrible crash could be heard. Second car, the same. One monk asks another, maybe we should say it clearer. How then? For example, the bridge is broken. We scientists can be these monks. Let's take care of our souls. Thank you.